600 straight games. Maybe not tough, but those are really hardcore games. We have, that's the headquarters of the Mexican MLB, which you've heard about earlier, the Texas Mexican Mafia. In Austin, we have the Latin Kings, the Texas Syndicate. In Waco, we have the Dirty Fight Boys. In our Austin division, we have the first prison game that we believe is going to become the first major international prison game, and that's the basically, San Antonio, we've been trucking games since about 1986.
So I guess it's a better question for you is what groups don't you have? Good start. Thanks for that additional information. And we're going to move on to our first time. In the first part of our program, you heard Craig Trent now want to talk about some of the common issues and concerns that they hear from officers throughout the country. One of those concerns was how to identify gang members. So I'm going to start with you. Identification. You've got an individual in your caseload. You suspect it's a gang member. What do you do to try to identify them as such?
Well, ideally, Mark, you're going to start in the early, probably the pre-release phase of the case when the person's still at the institution. You want to get all that text file and become what I call intimate with it. Cover front to back, find everything about this individual that you can prior to his release. So if they've gathered any intelligence over time while the person's been involved in the Bureau of Prisons. After that, you want to look at the person's report itself, the instant offense, co-defendants, prior record on the part of the individual, what type of crimes has been involved in, that could be a telltale sign. You then want to speak maybe with the precinct writer, the AUSA who prosecuted the case agent that investigated the case. The whole thing, all that will keep some type of picture for you one way or the other. In addition to that, you can reach out to your law enforcement sources in the community, state and local law enforcement, where they might be more expert in the area than perhaps the case agent was. They could give you a better idea of who has this person to identify in our area and as an identification.
Is that a part about the criminal, the offense, focuses on what goes back a little bit to what Craig Trapp was talking about with the criminal behavior versus visibility issue?
Thanks.
Rachel. How about how do you identify folks in the latest game
members? Well, to continue on what Tom said, issues. And additionally, you know, there are times you can just ask them.
Just ask,
you know, if they're a gang member. And they may or may not, you know, respond to that question. But if you have clues and suspicions from other things that you've looked at in the case, it will lead you, you know, to believe that you need to at least ask the questions. If they don't give you a yes or no answer to begin with, or if they say no, you might want to continue, you know, backing off. Is anybody in your family a gang member? Do you have friends that are gang members? Are there gangs in your community? Where, you know, where do you live? What kind of neighborhood is that? Something else that you can look for in identifying one thing in particular, for instance, and everyone has their own distinctions, but with the badger and fall rates. If I walk into somebody's house and I look in, instead of there being a telephone on the kitchen wall, like is in most people's homes, there's a six-digit business line, a six-line business phone. There's a fax machine. There's a credit card machine. Yeah, things like that. Just be aware.
Rachel's correct. You cannot discount the offender's available source of information. But you also need to be aware of the distinctions between the different gangs. For example, like the street gangs, they're very proud of their affiliation. They wear it, they boast about it, they brag about it. Whereas, for example, the prison gangs, just by the nature of the type of organization they are and their own roles, they sometimes will not tell you about their affiliations.
Is that a way to differentiate if you have someone who's a prison gang as opposed to a street gang? Their willingness to come forward, does that help discern who you're dealing with, or is that, should you not use that as criteria?
Well, let me give you an example. One time I had a prison gang member who was a member of the Texas Syndicate, and he told me he was coming. And during the first visit, we went through the initial interview. I access control and other available aspects. I think it's very important, it's very essential that you verify employment for gang members. Many times gangs take the money they make at illegal activities such as jobs and buy into legitimate businesses such as car washes or parking cutting jobs or restaurants. When they do buy into these businesses, then they will give phantom jobs to gang members. So it's very important that the officer verify the employment of gang member
phantom jobs.
The person has a job on paper, they get a W-2 form, but they never want to work. professionalism of the game. You need to be aware of all these things before you hit the fan.
You have a good story in terms of knowing your offenders, knowing the culture. I think we have a few minutes. I would ask you to tell the folks that story.
Well, it was during a fiesta. We got a fiesta in San Antonio. It's a one-week party. But I attended a fiesta week with my wife, and we're going home. We have to go to this kind of desolate little part of the hemisphere park area in San Antonio. And as I was cruising this park, I ran into a Texas syndicate captain that I had under supervision with some of his bodyguards. And as I stood there talking to him, my wife sat down on the park bench, and she was surrounded by his bodyguards. And normally, you might think, well, this is a threatening situation. But actually, it was a sign of respect. And I was talking to their boss, and kind of guarding my wife. So that's the way I interpret it. But you also need to be familiar with it, with the culture of the game, per se. And again, all the games have different cultures.
I think it's a fascinating lesson. And knowing who you're dealing with. Rachel, I'm going to give you the opportunity to have the last word.
join a prison gang. That's it. You're in it for life. But some of the street gangs, some of the more youthful gangs, there is in some instances an aging out process where they do leave the gang. They burn out of the street life and they leave the gang. Some do, some don't. Some gangs are multi-generational. But yes, there is some validity to that. You can leave the gang if you're a street gang member for the most part.
Okay. Good question. Good question. Greg, do you have any additional on that? I think Victor pretty well hit it on the head. We want to information about defendants is in the PSI, which then goes to BOP after sentencing. Does this information automatically also go to SIU?
Yes, generally, if we have information from the PSI that we work into our intelligence database, the database itself is shared with SIU. They get updates to refresh their database. In terms of faxing the original PSI document, not necessarily, but what we'll do is take information from that and put it in our database and share it with SIU. So we essentially have the main elements of the intelligence in their database, but not always the actual document itself.
Actually, for Craig and Dan, Faxton, what do you foresee as far as Asian gangs merging nationally or within a district?
I guess we're trying to decide among ourselves.